Well, guys, I'm Andy. Thanks for having me tonight. I was a baseball player here from 2004 to 2008, so I've been removed from New Mass for a few years now. My little tag here says 2010. I was on a 5.5-year plan. Like a number of different majors obtained. You didn't mention one major. I was one of those guys that switched a lot, you know, trying to figure out what I wanted to do, what direction I was going to go in. However, I had one passion the whole time, and that was history. Grew up in a history family. So I ended up graduating here with a history degree, and all the while knowing I was going to have to go to grad school because I wanted to be a teacher. From day one, I wanted to be a teacher. And that's what I do now. I'm a U.S. history teacher to a bunch of ninth graders in Cumberland, Rhode Island, and I'm a baseball coach, which suits me well because I love baseball. I played here for 4 years. Thanks, guys.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for having me. My name is Galen Clements. I graduated in 2013, so just a couple of years ago. I was a sociology major here. I enjoyed it. It was tough at first. And then thanks to academic staff, they got me to graduate. But anyways, I played football, had a wonderful time with that. And now I'm a state trooper in Delaware County in Pennsylvania. So that's that's basically between Philadelphia and Wilmington. And it's right next to Chester City, so it's a pretty busy area.
How you guys doing? My name is Breon Parker. I graduated from here in 1996. I played football. You might say, whoa, look at back then, 96. So actually, that was the five-year plan. I was an All-American football player here once upon a time. And you know, it's kind of fun. And maybe even still, I don't know, you had to check the stats for me, but maybe still the only person that got Player of the Week for Sports Illustrated. But at the same time, it's like I come back now and, you know, usually catch a couple games, nothing huge, but, you know, I get the opportunity to bring my family around, and it's pretty awesome just to see how campus has grown and things like that. I want to commend you guys for actually coming here and taking the initiative to kind of spend your time and just hear what we have to say, and hopefully if I got anything that helps you guys, then I feel like, it's a success. Currently, I'm an assistant principal in Springfield Public Schools at one of the alternative schools. So we have about 9 different alternative schools. My particular site is pretty much 100% special education. So all those students there have an IEP, which means they get special services. And each building actually has the administrator that's the assistant principal is the person that runs that building. So you have one principal that oversees all of us. So definitely a different dynamic than maybe what you'll hear from, most typical schools. So with that said, I mean, at any point you guys got any questions for me, I'm actually excited and appreciate Ms. Hammond and inviting me here to do this. It's been a while. So I was definitely kind of eager to get here and talk to you guys, so appreciate it.
Thank you. So I'm wondering sort of, we can hear what your job titles are, and like we probably all have an idea of what you do, but don't really know like what does a state trooper do, we kind of know what a history teacher does, but can you kind of take us through like what is your day-to-day job actually like, and what are like the good things and bad things? Like, because we probably all have jobs where we don't love everything about it, but there's a lot of things we really like and a lot of things we don't like as much. And anyone can start. We don't necessarily need to keep going in the same order if you don't want.
Yeah, guys, I'm a teacher. We all know. Educating the youth of America. I use that term all the time to my kids. I think they're sick of me saying it. But what a responsibility that is. I don't know if anyone here has any interest in becoming a teacher someday. But sun up to sun down, having that responsibility to, mold that young mind. I love that term, molding minds, is something that, I never take for granted. So a typical day for me is just what you probably expect. It's in the classroom. Where's this world going right now? Everything's technology, right? I 10 years ago I was here, and I had like a flip phone. I can't believe everyone's standing on their phone. I get mad every day. Going to Mr. Tutkin's room, you better put your phone away. I take that in a heartbeat. But I see technology everywhere, and everyone in my school, you know what they're given the second they enter Cumberland High School? Their own computer. Everyone has their own laptop now. So it's incredible responsibility to educate these kids. And I know it's going to sound odd as a history teacher. Do I really care if they understand who fought in World War II? I'm not going to ask that. You know, and it doesn't, that doesn't matter to me, but, you know, having that impact to let these kids know that, hey, someday you're going to use some sort of skill that you learn in this history class in the real world. And you hear that term all the time, like the real world. We'll say it as a principal, as a police officer, you hear it all the time, and we say it all the time. But, you know, having that little chance to make that small impact. Everything's technology-based, guys, and I think you guys in college here understand that. And it's just a cool responsibility I have, being able to see the kids grow and little things like that. So, yeah, I'm a teacher. You know, I'm not out there doing too much, but I am seeing these little minds change. It's pretty cool.
So did being a coach, did wanting to coach baseball influence you in becoming a teacher because you knew you could do both? Or?
Yeah. You know, I took an interesting road. You know, I'm 31 now. I became a teacher 4 years ago. So when I graduated here, maybe some of you guys want to be teachers, you realize we don't have a teaching program here at UMass. When I got recruited from Rhode Island, where I still live, I was like, hey, absolutely. Playing in the A-10, playing college baseball, Division I college baseball, that's a dream. So I'm going to go with it, always knowing that at some point it was going to lead me to the classroom. Never thought it would take as long as it did. But, you know, athletics played such a huge role in it. You know, always knowing that, you know, that competitiveness, probably with you guys, you probably, in your mind, you say, man, how am I going to get this competitive out someday? Well, and luckily in my field, I get that for 3.5 months a year. And then I get to see the kids every day in the hallway and, you know, being able to coach the baseball team and have that little bit of an impact as well. It keeps that drive for me going, which actually makes me a better teacher and coach. So, yeah, it really is. Sports plays a role. Sports can probably play a role in any job you have, but I get to directly see that by coaching as well as teaching. So it's pretty cool.
It sounds like the best of both worlds. Like, you love being a teacher, but you also get to continue your love of baseball.
Yeah, teaching is my favorite thing for like 6 months of the year. For those 3 months that is baseball season, the kids tell me all the time, you know, if we lose a game, they know we lost the game because they know how serious I take it. They call me all sorts of names during the baseball season. But yeah, it's a cool way to keep that competitiveness, that love of sports, you know, out there for me. And then the kids feed off that every day. They feed off them.
You want to keep this in order here? Sounds good. All right. So, anyways, just like you guys here today. I stroll into work. I try and get there about an hour early every day, wearing my sweats and a t-shirt because I probably just got done doing a workout. Once again, same as you guys. Go into my locker room, and now rather than wearing shoulder pads, I wear a Kevlar vest, which is it's ballistic designed to stop any handgun. That's what it's designed to do. So essentially, I strap that up. And then on top of that, I pretty much get changed in my uniform the same way every day. There's a bunch of different gear that I wear that's a function of my job. Starting with on my right hip, it's a Sig Sauer handgun, 45 ACP 227R. So in other words, it's a pretty tough gun. It's pretty cool. It holds 10 in the magazine, 1 in the chamber, always 1 in the chamber. Other than that, I have on my other side a taser. 2 sets of handcuffs, let's see, tactical flashlight, police radio, and a backup revolver on my ankle, because in law enforcement, you always want to carry a backup. So that's what I do. Get dressed up, get ready to go, listen to music. It's just like getting ready for practice, no different. Then essentially, I get my car set up after that, my police car ready. And as I'm doing that, you know, it's habitual. I do what I call 30 draws a day. So every day, do 30 draws to just get that muscle memory going. When I get in my police vehicle, there's a few different pieces of equipment in there as well. So starting with the onboard computer, there's that. Then there's the police radio, which rely heavily on that. Inside the back, we have a rifle vest, so it's designed to stop a rifle shot of anything up to a .308, so that's a pretty large caliber bullet. And then also have an assault rifle next to me. That's just every day, that's how we patrol. So once you're out in the car and you're all started up, you're ready to go, that's when the shift starts. From this point forward, the most key function of my job is to stay safe and to make sure all my brothers and sisters stay safe as well. So we have each other's backs. I think you guys know what I'm talking about with that. Anyways, then it's my job to handle the calls that come across on the radio. So any given day, at any given moment, there could be a call that's directed for me that I need to handle. So a few calls that I had, I just wrote down a few examples. I always refer to my notes, so bear with me here. There's minor calls that people call in that are like really kind of bogus, but we were required to respond to anything, and that's called a C officer. It doesn't really require too much work. Then there's some bigger things like trespassing, retail theft, car vehicle crashes. They occur all the time. We handle crashes, you know, left and right. Simple assault, aggravated assault, and then like domestic violence. And that's pretty much in our book, that's the hot call. That's the big one where you always have to be careful responding to. So basically, control the call. You go to the call safely. You get there safely. You handle the situation, and then just like you guys in class, what happens is when you handle a situation, they cut a number and they put it on a pending list. So it's just like getting assigned a homework assignment. So, as a great instructor once told me, for every 5 minutes of fun that you have is 55 minutes of paperwork, and they hold you to that. So this pending list builds up. As you take more calls, you have more things in the pending list that you're required to do that's just like homework. You know, that's basically the daily grind right there.
Galen, when did you know that you wanted to do this? I don't remember you talking about this when you were a student necessarily.
Yeah.
Do you know when you kind of realized this is what you wanted to do?
Yeah, when football was done for me. Sorry. So basically, I had a tryout with Tampa Bay Buccaneers when I graduated from here. I went in there a little bit banged up and injured. I pulled my hamstring during pro day. And for whatever reason, it was just everything for me was plan A. Everything was plan A, plan A, plan A. And the good thing is that I had in my basket was my plan B was graduating, because Tammy and Lance and Pete, they got me to graduate from this fine university. So luckily, when I was back at home and my parents were starting to get sick of me, I started just applying for different jobs, and there I found it.
What do you like the least? Paperwork, I'm guessing? What you said?
Paperwork. It's the worst. Okay. Just like, you know, you guys don't like doing homework. I don't like doing it either. Y'all got to do it, though.
I feel the same way. Thank you.
So, a typical day for me. There is no typical day. I pretty much, the only thing typical is, you know, I dress like this. And, you know, when I was a teacher, you know, I taught probably 6 years before I became an administrator. So this is my 6th year being an administrator. And, you know, I had a young, he was half black, half Hispanic young man. He came to me and he said, "Mister," and this was what I had on, it's pretty much similar. "Why you got on a tuxedo, mister? Why you always come in a tux?" And I go, "Wow." So then he had 3 other kids with him. They all, "Yeah, mister, you always dressing like you're going to a funeral or a wedding or something like that." And I remember asking the teacher if I could grab those guys for a few minutes. And I really just pulled them to the side and talked to them about what professional attire looks like. And just really understanding, you know, my upbringing a little bit. And just, you know, you grow up in the city, whatever, and you really, it's just whatever you pretty much have around you that kind of guides your perceptions, so to speak. And so I just really felt like I had to talk to those guys. And then, you know, I just kind of hoped and, you know, kept kind of, you know, working towards being an administrator. And I told myself that if I ever have the opportunity, I was going to dress like this as much as I can, unless we do some kind of fundraiser or something like that. So all that to say, a typical day really doesn't exist. Even in my role, when you're the site manager, you're also the principal, you're the assistant principal, you're a counselor, you're the parent liaison, but at the same time, you're supposed to be an instructional leader. Typically, in the position that I work in, the type of school that I work in, you get a lot of turnover. You have some tough kids you're working with. Sometimes they're no fault of their own, just a lot of times just, you know, it's very common to have an 18-year-old that's in the 9th grade that has a second or third grade reading level, and you got to get them graduated in the next, you know, 3 or 4 years. So it's a tough gig. It's a tough gig to do, and it's not what I like to call a fit for everyone. A lot of people come in, they game to do it, and at the end of the day, it's not for everyone. Even myself, sometimes it's just, you know, I have to check myself. But then I also say, you know, if not me, then whom else? So with that said, I try, like, I'm scheduled from 7 to 3 every morning. Our kids come in the door at 7:30. If I get there at 7 o'clock, I can pretty much count on having a horrible day. So I try to be there anywhere between 6 and 6:30. There is no such thing as getting out when the buses leave. So our kids leave at right around 2:30. And it's just not a given. You know, when you have students, and literally our building has 100% special education. And I don't know if you guys that are in education, you understand what the special education laws and things like that are, but every student that comes in our building are referred. And basically they're referred based on their social emotional needs. So what that might mean is I could have also on the flip side that a student that's advanced in MCAS, proficient, has a 110 IQ, but at the same time, they have emotional disabilities that get in the way of what, you know, accessing the learning. So they may miss 45 or 50 days, and you have to figure out how to still get them done and still try to meet those therapeutic needs. So, you know, it's a challenge. Literally, the good thing I can say about it is that day is over pretty quick. I know for everybody else the time is the same, but by the time you bang, bang, bang and really deal with everything, you look up and it's like, oh my gosh, everything's done. So you could literally have had dealt with 100 things and then have to type 100 things after. But it's like, okay, it's over, now get back to work. The cool thing I can say about education just in general that I always try to point out to my staff is that you get a lot of days off. Like, a lot of vacations, weekends and summers off, and, you know, those kind of things. And every holiday that you could imagine. Like, for me, I'll be honest, it's like, you know, I'm married with kids. It's like, sometimes I'd rather be, you know, at work. I love them. I love them. Don't get me wrong. But it's just like when you get out of routine, you get out of the flow, and it's just like, wow. But everybody else is like, oh, snow day. It's like, no, snow day, I'm still there. The only time the administrators don't have to go is when they pretty much close central when they close the whole city down. So when they do that, then we don't have to go. But regular snow day for everybody else, I'll have to get up early, clean out the snow, and then go to work. Only difference is you don't have to listen to any parents. Don't tell anybody, but that's when I don't answer the phone. But for the most part, it's just one of those things where, you know, you just really, you grind a lot. And I think that's kind of the correlation with sports. That you know you're gonna have dog days. I was the type really didn't mind practice, but then when you become a leader of a building, a leader of people, you come to find out who's about what. Like, some people hate practice, and some people, you know, just have different temperaments and things that are going on in their lives. And then it's just like, those are the things you have to manage and still be able to run the school, because at the end of the day, there's goals and objectives that have to be met, or you're not considered doing your job. You know, that's the other bad thing about, you know, kind of education is, yeah, you get a lot of days off, but to really do your job well, you have to use some of those days and that time off to do some work. So, like, tomorrow, I'll be doing some, you know, some typing and things like that, just so I can kind of catch up and get ahead and those kind of things. But, you know, for what it's worth, it's like, for you think about it, you know, you got a couple hundred days where you have to put in some hard work, but you probably got 100 and some odd days that you're not doing anything, you still get paid for it. So that's kind of what the trade-off is, I would say. So
I'm feeling jealous.
Anytime, come on.
Okay, thank you. So my next question is, just briefly, can you tell us if your major or the major you graduated with is related to your degree, and if, or, you know, maybe if you found how it's related to your degree, if you didn't think it was originally?
I guess I'll just keep going down the line.
Go for it.
Probably that's yours is sort of obvious. Right?
Yeah, well, right off the bat, obvious, right? History teacher, you got a history degree. But then to become a teacher, that's where it gets the struggle kind of starts a little bit.
Yeah.
I don't know, yeah, so I had to go back. Maybe you want to be a teacher someday. You, oh, I'm sorry, that's okay. I'm just going to roll with it. Yeah, that's fantastic. And so it's an interesting process where you go, you know, 4 years and this mindset. And I tell my kids this all the time. You know, You put in hard work now so that later on it pays off. I graduated 5.5 years, 6 years. The buddies used to bust me up here. I was the only baseball player in study hall for 4 years. And I had to be in study hall. I couldn't get my grades up. And now, like, I look at it now, I'm almost proud of that because that work ethic grew from there. Following college, I got married at 22, had my first child at 24, and I'm throwing boxes on a conveyor belt for almost 4 years, from 9 at night to 7 in the morning. And here I am, you know, at one point in my life, I was like, all right, I'm a somebody. I'm a Division I athlete. You know, just like these guys get some sniffs in the pros when I was in high school. I come here to UMass, and it didn't work out the way I anticipated it working out. So I always thought I was like a somebody, at least in my own head, which maybe some of you guys, maybe you get brought down to earth someday, and it's a reality check for everybody. And I'm sitting there throwing boxes. I have a college degree, and I'm throwing boxes on a conveyor belt. Honest living, I met some of the best people I've ever met in my life doing it. But I knew something was out there more, for me at least. And that's where the fun began. You know, that time, my wife and I, who graduated here from UMass as well, you know, we have two kids, and then we both decide we want to become teachers. She's a psych major, I'm a history major. So at one point in our life, we have two small children, we have two full-time 40 to 50-hour week jobs, and we're going to school full-time at night, on different nights. So when I look at my degree, I'm like, great, history. I become a history teacher. But man, that's not where the battle ended at all. You know, lucky for me, I found a great program, Johnson & Wales. Got certified in four different subject areas. I finally realized, at some point you have to look at yourself and say, you have one chance to do this. And I'm 25, I think, at that point. And I say, we're going to put in this 2 years of really hard work. And man, it was a grind. It was awful at times. But I put in those two hard years for the next 40 years of my life. I said to Tammy before this, I said, I never, one time since I started becoming a teacher, go to school, because I don't go to work. I never go to work. I love my job. And it's probably because I had all those years beforehand to show me what real work was like. Now I get to teach, I get to educate, I get to coach baseball. So yeah, I went to school here for history. And that certainly does play into what my degree and what my job is. But man, oh man, what a process that was.
And what was your degree in those 2 years?
It's a Master's of Arts in Teaching. And you know, you have the option to go one certification, two, three, four. If you guys know anything about teaching, one of the most competitive fields out there right now, there are so many people who have teaching degrees, so many. So I said, hey, I'm going to put this more hard work in. So my 2-year master's became 2.5 because I took on two extra student teaching courses. So I ended up getting those four certifications, and it worked out. My first year, I instantly got a job right off the bat, which in teaching, if you get a job right off the bat, especially in a public school system, when you're talking about retirement funds, you're talking about getting tenure, which is so important in the teaching field. Getting that job right off the bat in public school was something that I knew I had to get with two young kids. And because I put that work in those 2.5 years, I got a job working in an ALP setting. So all kids, similar to what a friend up here works with, emotional disorders. Anger issues, and I loved it, except my passion was history. So next thing you know, there was a few history positions, they asked me to do it, and I moved right into it. But if I didn't put that extra time in, I would never have gotten that history certification, and I wouldn't be where I'm at today. When I literally, my wife tells me all the time, she's like, Andy, you have to tone down your happiness. You have to tone it down. Because I'm with a bunch of my buddies, and I talk about how much I love my job, and I love going to work every day. And I'm like, oh wait, I don't call it work, I call it school. And it's the truth. I have to tone it down. That's how much I love doing what I do. You put in those hard work now, that's going to pay off in the long run. I tell my students this day in and day out. I've turned everything into a life lesson, just like what we're trying to do to you guys tonight.
I'm going to ask you a question that's not on the agenda, but I think you might be able to answer. What would you give to advice to students who don't know what they want to do? It's easy for you to put the work in, not easy, but you were willing because you really knew what you wanted to do. Like, what if you're a junior and you don't have that passion that you had?
That's difficult, right? To have that mindset. You hit your junior year of college, and yet you still have that unknown. Guys, the search never ends. I mean, we're up here right now. I mean, he said he didn't know what he wanted to do until his football career ended. Guys, that's part of life. But that mindset that, you know, teaching term, lifelong learner, that doesn't go away. So when you're junior in college, you're a senior in college, you just graduated, you still don't know what you need to do. The hard work doesn't necessarily end just because you graduated school. I know everyone has that degree in hand, that's great. However, you want to be that individual who's in that job for 30, 40 years? That's 30, 40 years, guys. These 4 years of education probably sounded like it felt like a long time. Imagine being in a job for 40 years. Maybe some of your parents are in that situation right now. The hard work doesn't stop. So it might take you a little time to get to that point where you realize what you were meant to do, and you got to put that work in to do it. Mine was when I was younger. Sometimes it's not that easy.
So just to piggyback off of that, you said like lifelong learner. I like that there.
I know.
Because I've been working, I've been working approximately 2 years now, and there's some old timers who say I've seen everything there ever is, and I try and stay away from that kind of stuff because I know I learned a lot so far, and I still have a lot more to learn. But gee whiz, I feel like especially like doing the stuff, you can never learn too much. You can never stop learning. That's all there is to it. But then to pick up with the question here, sociology didn't necessarily relate to what I do right now. I never took a class that basically prepared me for what I do, my daily grind, or to get in. I didn't necessarily study laws or anything like that. One thing that was somewhat similar, though, was when I was here in school, there was a constant struggle to get good grades so I could graduate and so I could stay eligible, but yet a lack of time to do quality work. You guys really do not get enough credit for what you do. Everybody should pat themselves on the back because you get it done somehow or another, but you don't have the time to do it. So you find a way to make it work. So good job, guys. And that's what I try to do too. I try and handle everything that I need to handle. I try and go out there and be productive. And then I try and get solid work done to investigate different cases. To hand in reports, so when I go to court a few months later, everything looks legitimate. But in my line of work, I guess it's a relatively thankless job because, it's not like you get a good GPA or you get anything like that. You don't get your papers returned with a star on it. It's either you do a poor job and you get your reports handed back and it looks like a crime scene, all red ink everywhere. You do a good job, you just don't see the report again. That means you're good to go. One other thing, though, I will say that I could relate to my job is communication. I really learned while being in the sociology major, and I'm sure a lot of you guys can relate with this as well, I learned how to communicate. And once again, and I'll keep mentioning the academic staff here, because they're the people who helped me discover this philosophy. I call it here the 1-1-1 policy. So bear with me here. You guys say are taking 5 classes right now. I challenge you. After every class, you stand in line at the end of class to talk to that professor. There might be a line of 2 or 3 people, just for a minute or two. You bring up 2 things to that professor. Hey, today I was paying attention and I really liked the way you worded this. And I understand it. I appreciate that. But I was a little confused when you mentioned this. Do you guys see what I'm saying? Every day, every class, I challenge you guys to do that. Now, the second one. Once a week, you email that professor about something random that has to do with class. Send them an email. Be on their radar. Now, the third and final thing is, once a month, you go in and you see them in office hours. You see them during their time. You schedule it. You put in the effort. Then when you get there, the professors, they're regular people. Just like all of us. They don't want to see a robot yes, yes, sir. Right? Or you don't want to see her, yes, sir, no, ma'am, whatever. It's like you walk into the office and you see a banner. Hey, you went to Penn State? My mom went to Penn State. Or, hey, I notice you have an old pair of track shoes sitting there. Do you run track? Because I run track. And it's communicating and it's relating to people. So then hopefully for you guys, because you are all delightful students, when it comes between the time to get a B or an A, the professor's gonna be like, oh, I remember this person, or in my case, a D to a C, but hey, that's all right. Whatever gets you through.
Did you do that, Galen, or did you just think?
I tried my best to do that.
I did,
yeah. Yeah, I did. And I stuck with it pretty decently anyways, I hope I could say. So anyways, I do the same thing on my job. I call it something different though. I call it rapport. You build rapport with people. So did you ever hear the expression, you attract more flies to honey than to try, you know, smack them? Well, it's the same thing. Be nice to people. Be genuine. It doesn't hurt. And you'll get a lot from people. So.
Can I tell a funny story about you? I remember
No, I'm joking.
You might be embarrassed, but it's funny. So Pete and I used to share a cubicle wall. A lot of you guys all know Pete. Right? Everyone likes Pete. So when you first came, were you a transfer student?
Yeah, yes. Central Michigan.
Yes. So when you first came and maybe were having one of your first meetings with Pete, I could hear what you were talking about because it's on the other side of the cubicle. And he asked you something about, you know, what you were going to do for break, and you said, I really just like to go home and chop wood. And I said, oh, Lord, we're going to have a hard time with this guy. Yeah. But see how things can turn out, right? You remember that?
You did have a hard time with me, though.
Well,
so.
No, but worth it, though. You know?
Yeah, thank you.
But do you remember that?
I remember saying that, and I still do. It's the best stress relief. I don't know if you guys ever chop wood. I'm sure all you girls here chop wood. You go home and chop, yeah. But
I love it.
It's a good time.
Awesome. I have a chainsaw.
So I don't remember what your major was.
My undergrad was, I had a bachelor's in educational studies, which at the time, it wasn't your typical educational teacher's degree. What it was I had gone to the dean and asked for special permission to follow a special education track because I knew that was kind of the direction I wanted to go in. Why did I know that? Well, a lot of things had happened prior to that. I actually went to junior college for a year and a semester, and then transferred into UMass in that spring. And you know, that young year, I'm literally coming in. I just turned 19 when I got on campus, and like most of us do, it's liberal arts until I figure out, you know, what I want to do or whatever. But then I always had kind of been drawn towards psychology. So after that spring, signed up for psychology major, started taking classes, and you know, at the end of the day, I was kind of doing what my mother called seeing my way through college. So I was getting a bunch of C's and sometimes lower, and or before it got lower, I would withdraw and get something else. But I tell you this, that you know, I'm 43 years old now, so it's like, you know, at the end of the day, I'm telling you something you maybe can't even connect to, but hopefully at some point, it's just gonna click. Something happens and you go, oh, I remember when he said so-and-so. But, you know, I remember having a conversation with one of our academic people here, and they were just kind of like, you know, you're really good with working with kids, and what do you want to do? And I started talking about psychology. Well, I want to do sports psychology or child psychology. And he said, well, do you plan on, you know, going to med school? And it was just something I had never thought about. And I was just like, nah, I really don't want to deal with that, to be honest with you. He's like, well, this is going to be your pay range. And I go, oh, that's not a good pay range. And I knew I didn't want to go to med school. So then we had a conversation about, you know, just being in education and just kind of the correlation between what things in psychology would do as opposed to, you know, in correlation with education. And, you know, the kind of medium was, you know, working with special education students. So I got an opportunity to do internship at a little campus at an alternative school in North Amherst, I believe it was, way back when. And, you know, I loved it. And the reality was, is like, I really only had to do a semester, but I ended up doing two more because I enjoyed it so much and ended up earning credit. So all that to say, I had a special degree, so to speak. Now, those that are looking to go into teaching, the problem with that is it doesn't have like a licensure track. So be like, if you're not sure what you want to do, just keep that in mind. You know, at the point, I just knew that was the population I wanted to work with. I didn't want to have, you know, 100 kids teaching the same topic every period. That's just not, I wasn't interested in it. But I did, you know, I kind of was drawn to the fact that, you know, you might have all these students and different learning levels. Like, that excited me to some degree with these emotional challenges. I felt like I was good at building relationships. So I said, okay, so I'll try it this way. And just really, really kind of geared towards that track. Now, when I got out, the problem with that was is you don't get hired right away because you're not licensed. And then something that I deal with now in hiring, if someone's not licensed, like a lot of times, you know, I won't even look at the resume. It's just not, because we have to have licensed people. Only time you really even deal with it is when you run out of licensed people and they kind of pick up other jobs, and then you try to see if they can get waivers, and it just gets really complicated. So with that said, if you know you want to do something in teaching, education, just try to make sure you're on track to be able to leave school with licensure. Furthermore, got that, ended up doing the, you know, I ended up doing residential treatment, still working with students and kids, but it was in a home setting. They still need the same kind of support. I was also like still engaged in education because I was like the education liaison, so to speak. So I felt like I was still using my degree in that way. That got really old at a certain point. And then when you start thinking of having a family and things like, you know, insurance and, you know, just things that you, when you're single, it doesn't really matter. You know, I just really had to start thinking about tenure and what is, you know, my 401k going to look like and those kind of things. And I said, well, then, you know, I got to start gearing towards, you know, public school and teaching. So I did teach for a few years, taught the same type of students basically. And, you know, fairly quickly, I was able to kind of get on track for education, for an administrative position. The great people here at UMass actually let me come back and work towards my master's in educational policy research and administration. So I don't know if you guys are involved, but it's called EPRA. That's yours? Oh, see, maybe I even saw you at some point. But yeah, and it was just awesome. And here's the reality. Like, I just little things, like I thought I knew how to write when I left as an undergrad. Come to realize my writing sucked when I got into grad school. And you just have really cool people in that department that just realized what talents you did have and what you need to work on, and worked with that in correlation with your goals. So kind of along with what these guys are saying, you got to connect with people now. Like, everything starts from now. You know, I remember kind of getting through my senior year. Like, I probably have been to that library, world-renowned library, probably three or four times, like literally around finals time. And, you know, as a master's student, you spend a lot of time there. I got to connect with some people that were all about academia, and it was just like, man. And I got up in there and I had a spot on the 20th floor, and I'm like, why didn't I do this? Like, why didn't I do this as an undergrad? I lived in 418 Patterson. There's a corner room there. I don't know if you guys know Patterson or not, but that building was the spot when I was there. And it's like, instead of just hanging out there, I should have been putting that work in the library. So a lot of little things like typing, something as simple as typing. Like, I got to type a lot and I hate it. Like, it's probably one of the worst things I have to do. And it's literally because I didn't put in that work. I won't lie. I used to write my stuff, but I never typed it. Somebody else would do it for me. And it's one of those things where it's like, especially if you're a junior, little things like that. If you have an opportunity to put in that practice and that work, do it. Don't allow somebody else to do it for you, because it's going to come in handy. You know, little things like I took 3 or 4 Spanish classes, and I still have to sometimes get, you know, somebody to come and translate. Why? Because I learned this literal Spanish, and a lot of it is, you know, Ebonics for Spanish with the parents I have to deal with sometimes, and they don't understand my Spanish. So just little things like that. Immerse yourself in different scenarios. I'm not saying you gotta go to Puerto Rico for a month and hang out, but what I'm saying is just understand those opportunities when they present themselves, you do that. And you put yourself in, just really understand that this is part of that plan B. Yeah, chase your dreams, do what you gotta do. But at the end of the day, you're gonna be left with whatever you've built up from now till then. So. You know, I took that opportunity with the master's degree, and it took me 4 years. I took a couple classes at a time. I had a couple of jobs, a couple new babies, was married. So I teach, drive up here after, maybe get a little bite to eat or something in between classes. I'd be coming home 10, 11 o'clock at night. So it's like, you guys are aware, even before where I was at. I got that master's degree in 2008, finally. So it took me 4.5 years to get it. And it's probably one of the proudest moments of my life, like, from the standpoint that, you know, my mother, I promised her my undergrad degree. And I was the only male, both sides of the family, that ever graduated college. And I told her that was hers. And I literally used to work towards that. Like, I don't even remember where it is, like, or what it looks like. That master's was mine. And I guess my advice to you is, if it's something, if plan A doesn't work out, and I don't know if you guys have professional sports aspirations, those kind of things, that plan B, make sure you're putting in a little bit in that bucket for plan B as well. Because it's gonna happen fast. That window's gonna open and it'll close just as quickly. Before I knew it, I mean, I left here, I was 22. That Masters, you know, I said, I got it in 08. And now it's like I'm to a point where I'm making the money I'm supposed to make, and I'm, you know, those kind of things. Not that that's all that matters, but just like if I had to kind of put that in perspective 10 years before, you know, I'd be that much closer to retirement or thinking about a second career and those kind of things. So, you know, with nothing else, I try to kind of be mindful of that. And those are the kind of things I talk to, you know, a lot of young people about, just really being, you know, we used to call it student of the game. You know, those kind of things. Like even these guys walking around with iPads and things like that. I tell you, we used to practice have meetings in the bathrooms and at the old stadium and stuff like that. And it's just like, you have to understand, like you have resources and do not let them slide by you. You have one of the best universities. I did not understand where I was until I left. I did not understand how awesome that library was until I sat in it, you know, in my 30s. And for that, you're here. And whatever you've done prior to, all I'm saying is you have an opportunity tonight or tomorrow or whatever to just really understand what you have. You have an awesome place and an awesome opportunity. So I didn't mean to dominate the whole conversation, but no, and it's really, because it's really a journey. And I think that's what these guys are saying. Like, I don't know, like I don't, like a lot of things I'm talking to you guys about, like I can't talk to 18-year-olds that live in a foster home. Because they just can't see it. Like, they can't see it. Like, they don't know if they're going to eat snack, you know, at a certain time. Like, they don't know if they're going to see their parents on the weekend. Or if they do have a visit set up and then that parent just cancels it. Like, so that I have to meet them where they are. What I'm trying to talk to you guys about is really just sometimes seeing the big picture. Like, and I know you hear that, it's cliche. But it's almost just like the big picture is always like right in front of our faces sometimes. And if you take a moment and just understand like what's around you, so to speak, it'll be clearer. Sometimes you gotta slow down. Like parties, like by the time I was a senior, I didn't even wanna go any parties. I just got lazy. Like that's what it was. I got lazy. I could have been at the library. And was I gonna read every book? No. But it was a place I was gonna go concentrate. Instead, I was picking up the phone to see who was gonna type my paper for me. And that's real. I passed. It was my thoughts. But at the end of the day, I don't have anybody. I have a clerk. I actually have a clerk. And it's like, how much she doesn't know my thoughts. There's certain things I have to type when I'm home. I got to do that. So with that said, just kind of think of the whole picture. Plan A, plan B, plan C. You guys are close. You guys are close. And you should be commended. And like just even sitting here talking to you, I remember just like walking around like the stadium and all that other stuff. And at the end of the day, it's like, make sure you also leave with what you're going to do next.
I was just thinking as you were talking, it's interesting. We didn't plan it this way, but all three of you would describe yourselves as not being very good students.
Oh, yeah.
Well, not you. You said you always wanted to do well, but you struggled.
Yeah.
I could have did better. Is what it comes down to. I probably left with a C average. I was better than that, but I knew it was enough to get by.
So you've talked about your sort of your career paths and how you got to where you are now. Did you ever use, you know, a big thing that we plug to them is networking and making connections and doing internships. Did any of that lead you to where you are now? Like any personal connections, you know, specific networking or someone who knew someone else who helped you or an internship? I know, Brianne, you talked about an internship, but I'm just wondering if you guys, you know, who you relied on to help you get to where you are.
Yeah, internship, no, you know, in education, at least in the teaching field, you don't necessarily do internships. However, in order to become a teacher, you have to do, you have to be a student teacher. I got my first teaching job in the same district that I had done all four of my student teaching jobs. So, you know, you leave that impression. So it's almost like a makeshift internship where I was learning as I went, I made an impression, and they offered me a job right after I graduated. So
it's almost more like an apprenticeship.
Yeah, like apprenticeship, yeah.
Okay, good. How about you, Galen? Do you have anyone who helped you sort of break into what you're doing now?
Yeah, basically just the support of my family and friends and everything like that. With, you know, what I do now, there's a pretty intense background check to get into with law enforcement. So, I mean, really, if you guys have any intention of doing something like that, anything in that sort of field, just know that they are going to be looking, you know, deep into your history. So it really matters who you hang out with. You're hanging out with, like, good people, people that maybe you shouldn't be hanging out with, you know, and that's really it. It's about, you know, staying clean, staying out of trouble, and staying away from people who could get you in trouble. But as far as an internship, I didn't really do anything like that. So.
And you said you did an internship and any kind of formal networking or mentoring?
Well, there was a woman that was here, Robin Harris, who had kind of been a support here for a lot of athletes for a while.
Jim Helling is the new Robin Harris.
Oh, okay.
They know Jim Helling.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you know, it's funny, to this day she won't tell me how she found me. But I had actually gone out to Boston for a while. I was doing some working out, trying to, you know, really figure out if I was going to do the football thing or not. That didn't work out. Went back to New York. My mother's originally from Alabama. She was like, I'm out of here. I only said I would stay until you graduated, and she left for real. So then I actually went down to Alabama, and then I ended up at the stadium at the Senior Bowl and talked to some agents, that kind of stuff, and, you know, just really realized that it wasn't a fit and I was done. And so I ended up, first time I had ever heard the term was overqualified. I tried to get a teaching job there and they told me I was overqualified. Somebody explained what that meant, and it just really, they just didn't see me staying there. And so they just said, okay, he's from the North. He's always been in the North. He's had no teaching experience in the South, and they can do that. They have that autonomy within that, you know, first couple of years. So it wasn't like it was discrimination. It was just, you know, it was a judgment call. So I ended up going back to New York. Was literally staying at a friend's house until I just really was trying to, you know, save up some money and figure out what I was going to do. Robin Harris found me there. And I have no idea. She wouldn't tell me. But I had literally did a workout, ended up, you see it, ended up cutting my mouth open. And I was like, that was my sign. Like, I ended up in the hospital that night, had a gang of stitches, and, you know, I had to stitch the gums back, had a hole here, somebody's helmet popped out. And I was just like, that's it. That was the sign that said, do something else. And I swear, I was sitting there, mouth with cotton and stuff for a couple of days, and she literally found me. My friend's mother brings me the phone, and she's like, you ever thought about an opportunity up here? And I'm like, no, because I vowed never to come back to Massachusetts. Just wasn't doing it. But that's young and dumb talking. So just one day, I had a conversation with my mom. Just said, what's the harm of checking it out? Came up here. There was an opportunity at a residential treatment facility, same working with the same type of students, that kind of deal. We had worked out something, and from here, that's pretty much where I started getting back engaged into, you know, still within the Springfield school district, that kind of stuff. My connection, crazy enough, when I started getting into the administrative track, one of the principals there happened to actually be in that class. So you never even know who you're sitting in a class with sometime. I had no idea this woman was a principal of middle school in the same district I was trying to get into. One day she caught me in the parking lot and just said, hey, what do you think about? And from there, just went for it. Taught there for 6 years, and then from there went on to administration. So watch who you're sitting next to, you never know. But in terms of people, a lot of different people that were supporting. But at the end of the day, those were the actual connections. And, you know, if you have family support, I didn't have personally a whole lot of that. My mother's always there, but at the same time, she couldn't guide me in, you know, the things I wanted to do. You know, she had her high school diploma. That was pretty much that. She's like, she tries to figure out why I even work with kids she don't like. But she says that jokingly. She loves any, you know, all kids. But at the same time, it's like one of those things where, you know, it's like connect with people that know what your goals are too. You know, when I talked to Ms. Harris, we would often check in just about a lot of different things. Girlfriend issues, all kinds of stuff. We'd just be passing through Boyden and we'd have a conversation. But she also knew enough to know the population I wanted to work with. She kept her ear open knowing I was a good person. And, you know, she thought of me. I had been long gone. So, you know, those connections are huge.
That's a great point, because I think a lot of times when we talk about networking, people have it in their mind, like, I need to go meet with someone who has the exact job that I want to have. Mm-hmm. But you, when you were, you know, casually talking or meeting with Robin Harris, you didn't know that someday that would lead to a job. But that's how you create a network.
I ever thought about
anyone for whatever reason.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
So, great. And I guess my last question is, how did you, like, kind of two questions you can merge into one. So, how did being a student athlete help you? Like, what were the key skills that got you to where, to the job you have today? And what advice would you give to them that maybe you haven't said already?
Well, first off, advice, just have your ears open at all time. You know, I was certainly a little stubborn when I was here at UMass, going back to high school, definitely here at UMass. And I wasn't always receptive to what people were saying to me. You know, I thought I had a lot of things figured out, when in hindsight, I think I had nothing figured out. Which you know, a lot of us will sit up here and say that. You just don't understand what's in front of you. And then once I kind of understood that, you understand a lot of people have your best interest at heart. And as long as it's the right individuals. So take that advice and run with it. And, you know, little things. For being a student athlete, everyone here knows, you know, what we go through on a daily basis. And I do that in the classroom. You know, little things like expectations, work ethic, having an understanding that what I see is easy, you know, Joe Schmo next to me doesn't. You know, when I look out of classroom, I realize that, just like a practice, when I used to not understand, maybe when a coach didn't understand why I wasn't doing something at the same speed, when I was a teacher, I'd take that into consideration. I have 30 kids in my class, and I know I have 30 different mindsets, and I have 30 different learning experiences, and 30 different ways that they understand what I'm trying to get across to them. So just being open-minded helps me and those individuals around you, especially in a classroom setting, for anyone who wants to be a teacher out there.
And yeah, just to plug away at that question there, one of the things that comes to my mind is just attention to detail. As we know, as athletes, that everything is about paying close attention to things, like whether you're studying your opponent or, you know, doing whatever it takes to get an edge on the game plan. That's what it's all about in real life. Just like in the classroom, if you guys didn't figure this out yet, just like if somebody ever mentions something twice, right? Is that right? It's important, yeah. As educators. Am I right? If somebody mentions something twice, it's extremely important. So take notes of stuff like that. Furthermore, like just as far as you guys are, you know, really close to being out the door, I think that you guys just need to really look in the mirror and understand who you are and what you're doing, and just be extremely proud of yourselves. And you know, that's the easiest way I could put it, because you're not in easy shoes right now, and you all are about to be very successful adults in the next couple of years, and that's a given. So hammer away and finish strong. Like, don't get the senioritis. Mm-hmm. Just finish strong, finish good, and you know, embrace it along the way. Enjoy yourselves while doing it, because this is a really good place to be. Have fun. If you guys could do it, go to Hobart on Friday. Go to the bars on Saturday uptown, because it's a wonderful time. Enjoy. Sorry, I shouldn't have said that.
If you go to Hobart now, you get arrested.
Yeah. Oh, is that how it goes now? You can't go to Hobart anymore?
Times change. Right.
So, you know, go to house parties elsewhere. Yeah.
That's a good thing. That's probably a good thing.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah.
So, I think that's pretty much all I have for you guys. And one last thing I just wanted to mention this too. I put this in my notes. So, just like manners, just wherever you go in life, just don't be afraid to be polite. Put a smile on your face. Hold that door open for somebody. It doesn't just have to be for a lady. Hold it open for a guy, young guy, old guy, lady. It doesn't matter. That could get you a long way. All right, now I'm done.
Oh boy, sports. Just so many lessons. I'll even talk about when I first got here. I kind of come from some quote unquote storied programs that won a lot of games and those kind of things. So I was fortunate enough to just be a part of, you know, like I was good, but I didn't have to be great every day. I had to learn how to lose when I came here during my time. And what I mean by that is that, not saying be a loser, what I'm saying is understand that you will have setbacks, but at the same time, you are in total control of your preparation and, you know, for the most part, what your outcome is gonna be. So with that said, like, I don't toot my horn a lot, but we lost a lot of games while I was here, at least for me. 500 is losing to me, sorry. But, you know, I was able to get a bunch of accolades. At the time, they weren't cool because, you know, we weren't in playoffs and things like that. Now I can look back and I go, wow, all right, so you did accomplish something. I can show my kids, you know, something else. And so it's really just the vehicle to talk to them just about work ethic. Being a student of the game we used to talk about. And what that translates into for you guys is, you know, really try to think about what you want to do 10 years from now, 20 years from now. And that doesn't mean it's going to be what's it. But at the same time, you can make certain decisions that'll kind of put you to where you have opportunities to make choices. On the flip side of that, you don't want to put yourself in situations where you don't have a lot of choices. It was very common for us, and I remember, to come back and, where's so-and-so? Oh, so-and-so didn't get his scholarship back. And you almost forget sometimes that those are year to year, or even semester to semester. Like, oh, I got a full ride to so-and-so. Yeah, all right, you screw up and see what happens. You come this far, it's like, don't waste the opportunity to kind of, you know, have yourself set for where you're trying to be in the future. Wait, some of you guys 22, 21, 22? Like, sometimes I have a hard time even remembering that. I ain't even gonna lie. But I remember so many of the relationships that I have. Some of my closest friends or teammates. Short story, I probably shouldn't have never come to school in the first place. I was supposed to get on a plane, come here, they lose my luggage. You know, I end up coming and, you know, a couple of guys gave me clothes. It was a snowstorm. I didn't even get on the plane. I got on the bus instead. That was before cell phones were really popping. Didn't call anybody, just kind of jumped on the bus. They thought I was like lost somewhere in the snow. But all that to say, you know, when I saw something like that, it just told me that these are people that actually really care about me. So when Syracuse came back around for the second time, and when Wisconsin came back around for the second time, and, you know, I had a small window to make a decision, it was about how I felt. At that point, I really didn't care what it said on paper. And I felt like I was somewhere where people cared. So if that's what you have, and I'm guessing, because this is what I remember about this place, is that, you know, you really embrace, like, those relationships, because before you know it, 20 years is gonna pass and you're gonna have gray hair. Well, my son says I have white hair, so he's the man for that. But, you know, it's gonna happen pretty quick, and you just really wanna make sure that you hone in on all those things. What I'm saying right now seems foreign. I know it does. I had people preaching it to me, maybe in a different format. I probably heard it a little bit, didn't really hear it until it was like, oh man, now what you gonna do? And so all I'm saying is just visit it from time to time. Just really evaluate what you've done, what you got in your back pocket when it's time to move on. I'll tell you, if you give me a resume, I'll sit there and I'll nod and I'll smile the whole time. But if you spelt something wrong or you didn't put the punctuation right, I ain't calling you back. I'm not, because that's going to tell me this is not the most important job interview for you. That's going to tell me that you weren't serious about your business. That's going to tell me that you're going to leave soon as another opportunity hits, because you didn't think twice to go and reread your work. So why would I even take you serious? So just something to think about. Second part of the question, what was that in?
Some advice about any skills that you use. You said work ethic was a big one.
Yeah, it was work ethic, and really just, I mean, now, like, I had a few surgeries back then. And I find myself now kind of taking care of myself. So me and my wife got this whole health and fitness and eating right and all this other stuff. Don't wait till you're 40. Like, don't wait till you're 40. Like, do it before you get high blood pressure. It's just gonna help you in your, and I say that, but I was there. I was there. Like, I literally, like, I don't look like it now. I'm getting close to back where I was playing weight. But, you know, I had put on some stuff. And it just comes from the daily grind. It comes from when you have kids. You don't get to work out as much. The metabolism slows down, but you still eat the Subway. Like, you just have to kind of maintain. And then with also not only, like, you know, just eating right, just really kind of taking time to focus on your mentals a little bit. It's very important. Every so often, my wife gives me an hour, God bless her, she gives me an hour every day where nobody bothers me, because she knows what I leave, and she knows if I close a certain door, leave them alone for an hour. I get an hour to myself. And those are things you just want to think about. Like, even now, it's good to practice aromatherapy, all that kind of stuff. So my advice, right, is really just more about, in order to make, you know, great moves, not good moves, you got to take care of yourself. All right. I mean, I didn't even understand what getting hurt was until I got here. But at the same time, it's like you take care of yourself and you put out your best effort. That's all it is. So with that said, I just really, again, I want to tell you guys, I really appreciate the opportunity. I've never sat in front of a panel of youngsters. Usually it's like little kids that don't want to hear what I got to say anyway, or their parents are going to find something to be upset about regardless, or staff that can really care less about what I have to say. And what I can say is I'm sitting in front of a bunch of future leaders, and I can see it. Like, I can see it just in looking back at you guys and knowing that, you know, it's a Wednesday, you've been to classes, you've been to practices, but you're here and you're attentive. And for that, you know, I want to commend you guys for being able to do that. And I'm gonna tell you, it's telling me I got to get back more. And I want to thank you for just kind of giving me some more energy by being able to sit here and talk to you guys tonight. Thank you.
Now, I want to open the floor to questions. So what questions do you have for them before we sort of break up the formal part of the interview? Haven't you been thinking of your questions the whole time?
Nope.
Yep.
How did the two teachers, how did you guys know, like, the age group that you really wanted to work with, like, when you made that decision? I mean, I feel like yours is more inclusive. You're an administrator, like, all ages, I guess.
So good question. I didn't really mention that. I actually worked at a preschool, one of my first jobs out of college, and it was cool because the kids, they just looked at you like this big monster, like you were like their dad. But that was a long day, man. They used to take naps, and that wasn't good because I would often like start nodding off with them. So then I realized, like, you know, I was kind of like, I got into that middle school age, and it was like, okay, they're old enough that you can have a conversation. You just got to get past the hormones and parents not used to their kids being out of elementary. So with all that said, probably somewhere in that, you know, early latency age up to about what I'm dealing with now. I even have some kids up till 22. Now, that's a whole different conversation when you're trying to tell them to walk in a line, and it's like, man, I drove here. Like, that's it. You know, it's kind of funny. But I mean, I guess I really didn't put an age group on it, so to speak. I more looked at kind of what I felt like I could offer at the time. And that's a huge question I also ask people when they come to interview. Like, what how can you help the school grow? Is like one of my go-to questions. How can you help the school grow? Okay, so I got this little, you know, this little guy here, he's a single parent home, he didn't eat this morning, how are you gonna get him ready to learn? And so that's a question I'll ask somebody. And you know, some people started with it, some people give you something else, but really what it comes down to is, I guess you have to kind of dab in a little bit of it. I mean, my younger brother was a special education student. He went to alternative schools from middle school through high school. It was strictly behavior, so I kind of felt like, you know, I had enough practice there, even at home, so it was kind of a natural fit.
And sometimes it's trial and error.
Absolutely.
You'll maybe know after two or three jobs.
But just be honest, too. Just be honest with it. I mean, the one thing I do see people do and they make the mistake is they'll get into that first job and just hang, and they're miserable. And they're making the kids miserable and the parents miserable. If it doesn't work, be okay with saying, you know what, this wasn't a fit, thank you for the opportunity, and then just know, all right, I'm gonna try this and this is why.
Yeah, it's big. I mentioned before I have four different certifications, and it was for that reason. You know, history is my passion, but when I thought about getting into the teaching, I wasn't sure if I was going to be a great fit. You know, I have 110 total students. I didn't know what it was going to be like standing in front of 30 kids at one time and trying to get them to understand what I'm trying to get across. So when I got those certifications, I put myself in a kindergarten classroom, and then I swung to on a fifth grade classroom. And it was like, you learn as you go, try by error. I realized, wow, like, you know, who I am as a person, how I approach young people, my sense of humor, best suited for a certain age group. And I found it was the high school level. And now I get to high school, and, you know, everyone's telling me, freshmen are the worst. You talked about hormones. You have some interesting issues going on there when you're 13, 14, maybe 15 years old. And, man, I love it. You know, it just suits me. But I didn't know that until I got there. So, yeah, I had a lot of apprehension of what I was going to do and how I was going to fit. But it's trial by error. And you figure it out. And then it clicks. And you're like, wow, this is perfect. So, yeah. Great question. Awesome.
Any other questions? Is anyone a senior? I know we opened the panel, but for seniors, no? Okay, so you all still have at least next year.
Juniors, you still got a chance.
Is anyone interested in an occupation that's similar to that's the actual same thing that they do? You mentioned teaching, maybe? Yeah. Anyone else going into teaching? No?
Can I ask, what are some of the people, what are some, you know, jobs you guys plan on getting into, or careers? County? Okay. I'm just curious. Like, I'm trying to, this is experience for me, too.
We got some unknowns out
there. I want to know who I'm talking to a little bit. So, accounting, and that's, to me, that's awesome in the sense that, I mean, if it's not points or money, I really don't want anything to do with it, but.
Well, I know the football players majors. I mean, you're landscape architecture.
Oh, wow.
Landscape architecture, yeah.
Okay.
I'm a psych major, and I was also thinking about
Ah. Awesome. You got to sign on with a big team if you're going to get paid.
And I know we have a couple of legal studies, poli-sci. Is that related to a job goal for you guys or just something you like to study? Like, do you want to go into law or politics or sort of?
Okay.
How about you?
I honestly want to be the mayor of my hometown.
Oh, yeah?
That sounds like...
No, nah, that's
doesn't
awesome.
Crazy at all.
Where's that?
Brockton, Mass.
Brockton.
Yeah. So that's what I want to do. I mean, I'm probably sorry right now.
I know Anthony Comer.
Anthony.
He's like a Comer. He's like a Brockton legend. I played with him in junior college, so.
Yeah. That's an awesome aspiration.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
A mayor. Wow. I might sit in front of the mayor.
I'll find a mayor to come to the panel next.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
See what I can do.
Any other questions? So I guess what we'll do now is just kind of break up. Please come up and talk to them individually.